a digital picture of Britain in the southwest tonight at 10 here on BBC4. Now, novelist Philippa Gregory heads to Bristol and Somerset in the company of Pevsner.
Between 1949 and 1974, Professor Nicholas Pevsner, a German emigre art historian, toured the counties of England, compiling a 46-volume guide to every building he thought was of interest, from Stonehenge to Centre Point.
Well, that is a puzzle. Can you have an 1190-looking arch on capitals which look 1220?
Pevsner's guides, regularly updated, are unique. Nothing quite like them exist anywhere else in the world.
Well, now for burial. Mind that dog.
In this series, six contemporary travellers take to the road with Pevsner's Buildings of England as their guide.
The story I want to tell is the story of a county which grew rich on the wool trade and was then tempted by the terrible profits of slavery. Somerset wool sailed down this river to be sold in Africa for slaves. They were then shipped to the West Indies and America and exchanged for plantation goods bound for England of tobacco, cotton, rum and sugar.
The slave trade is hardly spoken of now, but the evidence of it can be seen in many of the buildings of Bristol and Somerset.
Somerset is a serene county, varied in mood more than most, yet always mild. The extremes in landscape are the long, majestic lines of Exmoor, the crags and caves of Cheddar Gorge in the Mendips, the sudden bumps and mumps and knolls rising in unexpected places, and the watery stretches of Sedgemoor, lined with willow trees.
Pevsner and I see different things. His primary interest is architecture. But for me, as a historian and a novelist, the history of buildings is always the history of individuals, of people's lives. Pevsner directs us to this Henbury churchyard. But what is the story behind this extraordinary headstone?
It's one of the few pieces of unarguable evidence of the presence of black slaves here in Bristol. This boy must have caught a trader's eye, and instead of working on the plantations, was renamed Scipio Africanus and brought to England as a page boy, part fashion accessory, part pet.
He died, aged only 18, and was buried here to do his last task, advertising to all those who come in and out of church that slavery is a good thing, since it took this boy from pagan blackness and prepared him for a white heaven.
His gravestone reads, "I was born a pagan and a slave. Now sweetly sleep a Christian in my grave. What though my hue was dark, my Saviour's sight shall change this darkness into radiant light." Bristol sent out more than 2,000 slaving ships. Slaves were treated so inhumanely that thousands died on Bristol ships alone. Of those who reached the plantations, most were dead within 4 years. That's why it was the biggest trade of the 18th century and generated such huge profits all over Europe, because the plantations always needed more slaves to replace the ones who had died.
Many of the slave traders lived here, on Redcliffe Parade, where they could see their ships coming in loaded with sugar and rum and going out loaded with guns and trinkets and beads. They were respected members of the community. They served as church wardens in St. Mary Redcliffe Church, and it was a respectable trade.
When the first bill to abolish the slave trade failed in Parliament in 1791, St. Mary Redcliffe rang the church bells. They fired the cannons in the harbour and set off fireworks in a great party which lasted for 3 days and nights.
It's here at the Corn Exchange where the merchants met. And here's a nail where they closed the deal and put down the money to pay on the nail.
The exchange was built by John Wood, who brought to the serious business of making money the serious classical style he had launched at Bath. Pevsner calls it Wood's outstanding public building.
It lies back from the street, so as to make a better show of its reticent, carefully proportioned facade. Wood's building is composed round the open square court with colonnades, which had been the tradition for exchanges ever since the mid-16th century buildings of Antwerp and London.
The plasterwork by Thomas Pattie celebrates the sources of Bristol wealth with typical Bristol exuberance. Asia with camels and griffins, America with tobacco and Indians, and Africa with the cheerful head of a blackamoor. It's not refined. It's not fearful of making an error of taste. It's new money celebrating its own wealth.
They still trade here at the exchange. They even still sell beads.
Bristolians have a problem acknowledging their history. There are still many people in Bristol today who will argue that Bristol never traded in slaves.
This is Edward Colston, a great Bristol philanthropist. He endowed my school. Only in my final year at his commemoration service did a young priest let the cat out of the bag. He asked us where we thought the money had come from. It was slave trading. No one had ever mentioned it before. His motto, and the motto of my school, is go and do thou likewise.
He was a profiteer, he was a slaver, and a racist, and a benefactor for Bristol. But for the black people, he would always be remembered as a gross enslaver and a vile racist of the African masses, people.
Is the statue now a centre of controversy?
It will always be, but I'm not one of those who say bring it down. I believe it should stay where it is. By having him there, it's a stark reminder of Bristol's historic link with the Atlantic slave trade and the foundation of its wealth.
As the docks grew busier and noisier, and became unbelievably dirty with industries and slums side by side, the richer merchants started moving away. First, they moved up the hill here on Park Street, and then started building the village of Clifton.
Clifton is planned for leisurely traffic. With its crescents and terraces and generous greenery, no one can resist the charm of Clifton's confusion. Two characteristic features we see here for the first time: the raised pavement or terrace, and the gentle stepping or climbing of the fronts.
Clifton is a delightful jumble. When you see it from below looking up, it's like Tibet, all pale stone and tumbling down the hill. I was brought up here. We lived in a Clifton house, a Victorian terrace, Not one of the gems like the earlier crescents.
A crescent to beat all crescents. Royal York Crescent, of about 1810 to 1820, is well over 130 windows long.
These doors were probably for the unloading of household goods and for the entry of sedan chairs. But my mother used to tell me that this was where they brought in the slaves to be held in the cellars. In the face of official silence about the Bristol slave trade, all sorts of stories and myths can take hold. I used to slide down this rock every Sunday after church. It's been polished by the generations of bottoms of Clifton children.
Another of my childhood treats was to visit the camera obscura at the top of the hill. It's the highest point in Clifton and overlooks Clifton Suspension Bridge.
Although not one of the earliest suspension bridges in England, it must yet have appeared a miracle while it was built, owing to the giddy height of the gorge and the daring with which the span was bridged without any intermediate support.
The bridge is so much a part of the Bristol scenery, it's hard to imagine the Avon Gorge without it.
But it's not a necessary bridge. It doesn't lead to anywhere in particular. It's one of the joyful extravagances of a rich city, as if Bristol was saying, here's an extraordinary place to build a bridge. I wonder if we can do it. It took a major feat of engineering from Isambard Kingdom Brunel to achieve it. Astonishing, given that it was his first solo commission, and he was only 25 at the time. The rival designs make you glad that Brunel won the competition. But they didn't complete the bridge in one go. They ran out of money, and while the bridge was only half built, they sold the supporting chains. Only later, when they'd managed to get second-hand chains from another bridge which was being demolished, could they complete it. The bridge is not the only gleeful excess that slave money paid for in Bristol. Elsewhere in Clifton, wealthy merchants were indulging their taste for the new style of Gothic in houses and in gardens.
The finest piece of garden furnishing at Clifton is the grotto in the garden of Goldney House.
For a summer party when I was a little girl, and I remember the sense of complete thrill at coming round the corner face to face with Neptune, and then the sudden scare of seeing the lion. I didn't know it then, but that's a completely authentic 18th century reaction. You're supposed to feel delicious terror, and I loved it.
The grotto was built by Thomas Goldney, whose family business was trading as grocers in the slave-produced goods of the West Indies.
I suspect that there's a connection between easy money and wild taste. You can call it bad taste, if you like, the ignorance of the nouveau riche. But I rather admire the sheer cheek of someone who, earning a fortune, chooses to squander it in a vision of his own making.
Lost in urban sprawl, but even more strange and fanciful, is Arno's court, formerly a large estate. At its heart was a black castle, again in Gothic style. It was built in the 1760s by William Reeve, a Quaker copper smelter and brass founder.
William Reeve put his laundry here, his bakehouse, his brew house, and his stables. The building material is a typical Bristol combination of eccentric design and cautious execution. He used blocks of slag from his own smelting ovens, free and readily available. It gives it the blackest appearance. Horace Walpole called it the Devil's Cathedral. To imagine now, but William Reeve built a beautiful bathhouse just up the road here. It's gone now. After a hard day's work at his castle, he'd stroll up the road to his Arabian bathhouse and dive into his plunge pool, decorated with mermaids and dolphins. And then he'd go home to his lovely new house by underground passage under the road.
The house is now a hotel, and the castle is a pub trapped in the middle of a supermarket car park. It always was an oddity, and it still is. I rather like this incongruous neighbour for Sainsbury's. In contrast, the city of Bath, a classic piece of Georgian town planning built around the Roman spa, has been preserved, even frozen. Bath was a fashionable spa in the middle of the 18th century, but 100 years later it was totally eclipsed by seaside resorts as swimming in the sea became popular. It was because of its cheap property prices that in the early 19th century it attracted the social outsider William Beckford, who had been one of the richest men in England, but by then was looking for a bargain. Beckford was a legendary eccentric in his day, heir to 22 sugar plantations in Jamaica with 1,200 slaves. He was so rich he felt he could do whatever he wanted and was exiled from England after a homosexual relationship with a child. He came home when the fuss had died down and built the extraordinary Font Hill Abbey in Wiltshire, of which nothing now remains. It boasted a spire as high as Westminster Cathedral's and was constructed so fast and so badly that it fell down 3 times. In his old age, Beckford moved here to Lansdowne Crescent.
It's one of the classically beautiful Bath crescents built by Palmer. You can see what the plan was. It was to be a central building with 2 wings, perfectly, classically symmetrical. The order and the symmetry of it was quite destroyed by Beckford, who chose to buy 2 houses and connect them with a bridge.
At the top of Lansdowne Hill, in what is now a cemetery, is a tower that Beckford built. It's currently being restored.
This conception is just as crazy as that of the Font Hill of his youth had been. There's something bleak and sinister about the building, which penetrates into all its details.
Beckford toyed with the idea of turning this tower, his library and retreat, into his mausoleum. He was always highly suggestible, and he managed to convince himself that he would feel the coffin worms eating his flesh if he were buried underground. In the end, he chose to be buried above ground in this pink sarcophagus.
Between his tower and his house, Beckford made a garden, over 1/2 mile long and very narrow. And all along the way, he put a series of features, designed to delight.
This was his starting place, his garden house, a folly in Moorish style, a reminder of his novel Vathek, which is set in the fantasy land of Arabian Nights.
And here, inside a private garden with no public access, is the second feature, Beckford's Gateway.
It's extraordinary to find this in a modern garden. Marvellous it's not been pulled down or converted. It just stands here triumphantly in place, completely unexpected.
It looks Norman, but Beckford built it in about 1828, and decorated it with this completely fake heraldry.
When you first came and looked at the house, had you heard of Beckford then?
No, I must admit, no. No, I hadn't heard of Beckford at all. I read a few books about him, and I think he was a great fellow, really. Must have been, in his time. Left a lot behind. They say he had a menagerie of animals.
What sort of animals do you know?
They say lions and tigers, but I don't know. Of course, there weren't so many houses around here then.
The telephone box intrigues me. What made you think to put the telephone box by the gate?
Well, it's an old-fashioned telephone box, and it goes with the gate, I thought. So I quite like the telephone box.
So Beckford's love of the bizarre lives on. But from the top of the gateway in George Sparrow's garden, you can see that Beckford's ride has not been preserved. It's buried under this 20th century housing estate. Further up the hill, a few traces do remain. We know from Beckford's plans that from here the ride ran through an avenue of apple trees and then went into a dark forest of conifers.
It wound round the dramatic cliffs of a disused quarry and went underground into a grotto with a pool with dripping ferns, and from there to the tower. Beckford rode up to the tower every morning, accompanied by a band of handsome stable boys and sometimes his dwarf on his pony.
Esticum Garden, in the south of the county, is being restored by Philip White, who is continuing the tradition of the English eccentric. He was so inspired by this place, he staked his life and his fortune on it.
What's special about it? What attracted you to it?
Well, there wasn't a great deal to attract me to it when I first came here, because the whole valley was completely overgrown. The lakes were silted up and actually covered in trees. So there was very little to see when I first came here. But it had a magic about it, and I had this very strong feeling that I wanted to restore it.
And this must have been an immensely expensive piece of work for you, wasn't it?
It has been, yes. And, of course, the problem is that it's very difficult to get funding for a project like this when you start off initially.
So how did you get the money to do it?
Well, I actually had to mortgage my house in order to raise the capital to do it.
Your family home?
Yes.
Did you tell your wife that you were mortgaging her family home and your four children's family home in order to save an 18th century garden?
Well, my wife will tell you that the first time she heard about it was when she read it in the newspaper.
I would think that was a rather stressful morning, wasn't it?
Esticum was part of a new movement in gardening in the 18th century. As more and more of the countryside came under the plough, there was a nostalgic craving for untamed wildness. Gardeners became landscape gardeners, creating romantic features where none existed, like caves, lakes, and waterfalls. They studied these landscapes with temples and ruins, and here at Esticum, even a witch's hut.
The 18th century landscape garden is only one of the treasures here. Through this door is a pearl of our own century, a garden designed by Edward Lutyens and planted by Gertrude Jekyll.
Lutyens created these terraces and steps as if they were essential routes to and from genuine destinations. You don't question them. They're as easy as a cottage path from the garden gate to the front door. Jekyll chose the plants in such a way as to make them look as if they occurred naturally. Everything looks as if it is self-sown. Everything looks as if it grew by chance. Everything is spontaneous and crowded and natural. It's the sort of garden which cruelly misleads the amateur visitor. Of course it doesn't happen by accident, but the beauty of it, the art of it, is that it looks as easy as falling off a log.
And that's why this garden is a work of art, because it's great thought and execution made to look like a fortunate stroke of luck. It's like watching Fontaine dance or a painting by Turner. You'd think any fool could do it until you're the fool that tries.
Seaside Minehead belongs mainly to the 20th century, as the hotels on the front and the dreary, semi-detached gabled houses show. Concurrently, attracted by the mild climate and the sheltered position of Minehead, villas began to sprout out between the older development and all up the hills. Perriton Mead in Perriton Road is cultured Neo-Tudor, about 1922, by Morley Horder.
You can see what this is supposed to be. It's a garden modelled on Hestercombe. Here would be that wonderful wet Iris rill. And underneath these ugly paving stones is the softness of natural slate, which would gleam when the mist comes in off the sea.
This is where the water would have come out into a peaceful, thoughtful, semicircular pond. But it's not grand enough to be listed, nor rare enough to be preserved. It isn't a private house anymore. It's under the control of the council. It's a residential school for emotionally disturbed children.
Of course, this is the very place which should be beautiful. So we give the children a chance to live somewhere that lifts their hearts a little, that gives them a sense of joy. But instead, we worry most about uneven paving and unfenced ponds.
The garden here is following the fashion for Lutyens. But the house is 20th century mock Tudor. Not very far away is the real thing.
Of Elizabethan houses, the only one of front rank, nationally speaking, is Montacute. A perfect example of what Elizabethan designers did not often succeed in, to be large without being showy.
Pevsner may not find it showy, but it's very impressive and extremely grand. It's the British ruling class spending vast sums with exquisite taste. So it's all the more surprising that inside there's a plaster frieze depicting a story of drunken peasantry. Here's a henpecked husband trying to get a drink of beer and being beaten by his wife with what looks like a shoe. He's then publicly shamed for his drunkenness, paraded round the village on a pole. This looks to me like rough music, the Elizabethan tradition of publicly shaming badly behaved individuals.
Why is this here? Well, it could be because the Lord of the Manor rather approved of community control of the workforce by the workforce because it made his job so much easier. Or it could be a plasterer with a sense of humour.
Like most of these large-scale old houses, Montacute is now run by the National Trust. But some historic treasures can still be found in private hands.
Cotte, is one of the most perfect smaller English manor houses of the late 15th century. It is not large, looks warm and comfortable in its reddish-brown stone, and has all the picturesque informality of plan and elevation which the Renaissance was so anxious to get rid of.
Cotte is a family home as well as an architectural gem. It belongs to Alistair and Mary Ann Robb, who bought it only 5 years ago.
It's an incredibly beautiful house, but what's it like in practical terms to live here?
It's marvellous because it's not too big. It's lovely and warm in winter once you've heated it. The walls are so thick that it stays warm, providing I can get the family to shut the doors because that kills draught. But otherwise, marvellously comfortable house. And it's so beautifully simple and unpretentious that it makes a marvellous family home.
Yes, I would endorse that. I think he's absolutely right. And if you live in a large house, well, larger than most people's houses, in a way it's much easier because you don't have to be so tidy. And a house like this, I always think living in old houses, they should have an air of faded elegance and smell of wood smoke and polish and poupiere. And it doesn't matter if things are slightly old and tatty, because that lends more atmosphere.
It's a very striking ceiling as well, very high ceiling, very beautiful.
It's not a ceiling, oh. It's a roof.
Okay.
And it's massive construction. And I think it's all as it was in 1480. I don't think there's anything been replaced there at all.
Yeah. At the bottom of the beam are these little carved figures. Marianne, what are they?
Well, they're symbolic, really. They're wingless angels. And I think, really, I like to think that the reason that they're still there guarding the house today is because they don't have any wings and they've never flown away.
The village of Dunster, in the southwest of the county, dates from the same time as Cotte, and despite the traffic, there's a real sense of the medieval period here.
This little building is the yarn market, where the shepherds of Somerset came to sell their fleeces. You can imagine this broad street turned into an open market, with carts unloading fleeces, yarn traders buying wool, and dogs barking, sheep bleating, and the noise of bargaining.
The prosperity of this village, of all Somerset before the 18th century, was on the backs of sheep. That's why the Lord Chancellor still sits on a woolsack today. It's not surprising that the hymn, All Things Bright and Beautiful, was written here. The look of the 14th century continues in the tiny National Trust village of Blaise Hamlet, built by a Bristol merchant.
Maybe John Harford was harking back to the social order of the Middle Ages when he built this fake medieval village in the 19th century for housing his retired workers. is fantasy architecture, designed by John Nash, who also built the Brighton Pavilion.
The cottages are grouped along the curving sides of a kind of fairy village green. If they are all top-heavy, that is due to the desire for a picturesque skyline. Then there are pantile roofs and stone slates and coarse thatch. Place Hamlet is indeed responsible for some of the worst sentimentalities of England. Its progeny is legion and includes Christmas cards and teapots. Why, then, are we not irritated, but enchanted by it? I suggest that its saving graces are its smallness, its seclusion from traffic and commerce, and the nicely maintained degree of artificiality throughout.
Actually, I plead guilty too. Like Pevsner, I rather like it. So what's it like living in someone's dream of an English country village?
Oh, it's fine. It's fine. The neighbour's good. We're all friendly.
And are there restrictions for living here? Things you can and can't do?
Well, no, not really. We're not allowed to do anything, any alterations to the outside of the buildings. We can do what we like inside, but we mustn't do anything to the outside structure of the cottages.
No satellite dishes or television aerials?
Well, we shouldn't really have television aerials, but if they're out of sight.
And any restrictions about gardening then as well? Garden gnomes? Well, are you allowed garden gnomes?
No, I wouldn't think so. But we can't have... Well, they don't like us to have any exotic plants.
Why is that?
Well, because they just want an English country garden, don't they?
And it looks... I mean, it's very, very picturesque, but there's no street lighting as far as I can see.
No. It's all dark in here at night.
So what do you do if you want to go out in the evening?
Well, you just take a torch with you.
Oh, you're allowed torches then? You don't have to have candles?
Well, you can have a candle if you like.
At Blaise Hamlet, they're working very hard to maintain a fantasy about an England that never was. But Wells Cathedral conveys an overwhelming sense of conviction. It's a monument to the majesty of God. Originally, this facade would have looked very different.
To visualise the facade as it was when completed about 1250 or 1260, it must be remembered what part colour played in it. Enough remains have been found to make it certain that the backgrounds of the niches were painted in strong colours, and the figures as well. And we can assume from evidence in other places that gold was extensively used too. It is hard for us to imagine what that must have done to the facade, and harder still to decide whether we would have liked it.
It was probably much too bright for the modern eye. We tend to equate antique beauty with pallid tastefulness, rather like the Protestant reformers of the 1500s who whitewashed the entire cathedral. It was the Victorians in the 1840s who undertook the Great Scrape. Unfortunately, in their overenthusiastic scrubbing, they took off the original colour as well.
The interior does exactly what it's supposed to do. You can't resist a sense of awe and inspiration. It makes you feel very tiny. It's a religious experience evoked by stone and light.
When you come into a great space like that, it tends to sort of resonate with you and pick up something which you don't know about yourself, and you begin to live at a different level. And I think this place, or cathedrals in general, have that effect upon people, and they make them feel different somehow. And perhaps that will speak to them of something transcendent or spiritual, whatever that means. There's also an intimacy that if you go into the choir, for example, it's not that large, and you're as it were, intimate with each other, you're close to each other, and there's a sense in which you're also close to God, or whatever you call God when you're there. So there's this space and intimacy at the same time.
When the cathedral was built in two periods in the 12th and 13th centuries, people would have shared a vivid spiritual life. Our society has lost that almost completely, but I'm so struck here by the fact that this isn't a shell or a relic of something which once existed. It works today, as it always has done. Three times a day they hold a service here. It's not a curiosity, it's a real place with living concerns. Architecturally beautiful and deeply moving. If it wasn't the apologetic old Church of England, we'd be stunned by this. If it was a Buddhist temple or a Muslim shrine, we'd be enormously impressed at the combination of such beauty and spirituality. At Glastonbury, New Age spirituality, paganism, and Christianity all collide. For 500 years, the Abbey was the greatest church in England until it was superseded by Wells in the 13th century. Glastonbury was destroyed by Henry VIII during the Reformation. It's now a much-loved haunt of ley line traces. We're in the heart of crop circle country here, and this is where we go backwards, from history into legend.
Glastonbury Abbey was founded on an eminence above the meres by King Ine, about the year 700. Legend tells us that history goes back yet further, that Joseph of Arimathea landed at Glastonbury bringing the Holy Grail with him. Legend also identifies Glastonbury with Avalon and makes it the burial place of King Arthur.
In 1191, the monks of this abbey were raising funds to expand and rebuild. Incredibly, at this very moment, they found in the graveyard a lead cross inscribed in Latin with the words, "Here lies buried the renowned King Arthur," in the Isle of Avalon.
Down they dug a little deeper, and there they found a coffin holding a large man, and at his side, a small-boned woman. Who else but King Arthur and Guinevere at his side?
Visitors have flowed in ever since. It's a great story for putting Glastonbury on the map, and it was probably created by the monks for that very purpose. If Glastonbury Abbey is where Arthur ended up, which frankly I doubt very much, this is where he's said to have come from. This is the road to Camelot.
A tremendous Iron Age camp covering 18 acres. It is the mightiest prehistoric camp in Somerset and one of the mightiest in Britain. In ancient times, it was certainly the focal point of many trackways and encampments, it is easy to understand why its construction should have been attributed in folklore to King Arthur, and why it became identified with the legendary Camelot.
The story goes that Arthur was the only one who could lift the famous sword from the stone anvil and thus become king. He was advised by Merlin the magician. He married Queen Guinevere, and she fell fatally, hopelessly in love with Lancelot, Arthur's best friend. Here, they established an elite democracy, and anyone could join if they were brave and chivalrous. And the women were all beautiful. And there were no cars or industry or dirty money. And it never, ever rained. And in a sense, we come full circle. Scipio is an Englishman just as much as Arthur, but we've yet to weave him into our view of the past. He's one of the many ancestors whose lives we've yet to discover through the layers of cheerful legend and sanitized heritage. The ones we're proud of, the ones we're ashamed of, and the ones we've simply forgotten.
And don't miss A Digital Picture of Britain in the West Country tonight at 10. But stay with us now for another Samuel Johnson short next.